Welcome to the UGC EPG Pathshala lecture series in computer science. In this series of lectures, we have been looking at database management system. For the past few sessions, I have been talking about data mining. Last session, I have typically concentrated on classification, and the previous session, I have talked about association rule mining. So, looking at different mining methods or techniques, we have one in row which is called clustering, which is also again a part of this data mining technique. The major learning objectives for this particular session, we will start introducing on the cluster analysis. We will explain more on the various types of clusters in cluster analysis. We will try categorizing major clustering methods, and we will talk a little bit on the outlier analysis also. This we would have seen it as part of discussion in the classification. So, as I have clearly indicated, anything which does not have a class label are clearly termed as unsupervised learning. If there are previously defined classes to which this predictive result belong to, then it falls under classification. So, I repeat it again, supervised learning is typically for classification. Clustering uses unsupervised learning. In case of supervised learning, the training data, which are values from observations, measurements, are accompanied by labels. So, I create labels which are primarily by observations or measurements, indicates the class of observations, and any new data is classified typically based on that training set. So, any value that has to be tested, any attribute or record that is given as input will be based only on the training set, whereas by use of unsupervised learning, we are not working so. The class labels of the training data is totally unknown. So, to which class this belongs to, it is not properly been defined. It can belong to a new category also. So, given a set of measurements or observations, the aim is to establish the existence of classes. If there would have been a class, then we might include that into the specific class or a cluster in the data. So, now let us try understanding or get closer into what this cluster analysis mean. Clusters are nothing but a collection of data objects. If you look at this picture, there are a collection of data objects which are represented by different colors. So, squares exist with different colors. So, every square is supposed to be a data object. A collection of data objects becomes one cluster, that is similar in terms of properties. So, those with similar in properties and characteristics belong to one cluster, and this completely vary in terms of properties, then this belongs to a different cluster, and we have third cluster. So, by looking at this picture, we can clearly say that this belongs to three different, or the given list of data objects belong to three different cluster values. So, those that are similar to one another in terms of either properties, we mention it within the same cluster, or those which are dissimilar to the objects that might belong to other cluster. So, here this will be mentioned as cluster 1, this will be cluster 2 and cluster 3. So, this cluster within cluster or intra cluster will have similar properties, whereas inter cluster there will be a large difference in the property values. So, by looking at the cluster analysis, we group a set of data objects into a specific cluster, and clustering is purely belonging to an unsupervised classification strategy, where we do not have any predefined classes. So, there are clearly no predefined classes. If we typically look at any cluster analysis, the applications of cluster analysis are twofold. One, it can be used as a standalone tool to clearly look at the insight into the data distribution. How are the data distributed can be studied by looking at an independent tool, or we might use this cluster as one of the pre-processing step for any of the algorithms where we tend to study the behavior and the characteristics of different data values. Now, let us look at where these cluster analysis been applied. If at all we wanted to understand on the pattern, we can apply this cluster analysis. Not only that, we can also use spatial data analysis. We can use this cluster analysis for spatial data applications like create thematic maps in geographical information system by clustering feature spaces, or we can detect spatial clusters and explain them in spatial data mining. We can also put them into image processing where we can identify skin tone and non-skin tone regions of say facial images. If you look at facial images, there are a group of skin tone regions which are like chins, nose, forehead and all the other stuffs. These are skin tone regions and non-skin tone regions where there is a coverage by hair. So, to identify these two regions together, we can put it up as a cluster. So, identifying every data object and understanding on the pixel clearly distinguishes between these two clusters. This is one of the image processing technique. Likewise, to many image processing techniques, this can be applied. And not only that, this can even be applied on an economic science where we can study on the market research. If you look at closely on the World Wide Web strategy, document classification typically uses a cluster strategy, a cluster scenario, or a clustering a web log data to discover groups of similar access patterns is also an application of cluster analysis. As I have hinted, here come some of the examples of clustering applications. How would this cluster help for marketing? So, this cluster helps marketers discover distinct groups, unique groups in their customer bases, who are a group of customer who will purchase this list of items, and then use this knowledge to develop targeted marketing programs. So, targeting on them, whatever that we created as a new product, we can target only to those customers who are created already into that one cluster. And in terms of geographical information system, land use, identification of areas of similar land use in an earth observation database. So, we can have fewer cluster of data values which can be identified as what kind of land it is. So, earth observation gives us such interpretation of finding out to which class to which cluster this might belong to. And we can use this for insurance based applications where we can identify group of motor insurance policy holders with an average or high claim cost. Not only that, these cluster applications can be extended to city planning where we identify a group of houses according to their house type, value and geographical location, like high income group, low income group and medium income group category, to which category we might have to put these list of people or these group of by looking at their value and location, geographical location, we can clearly plan on the city. Further, this clustering can also be made for studying on the earthquakes. So, observed earthquake epicenter should be clustered along continent faults. To get closer into this cluster analysis, we look at different clustering methods, but what we majorly aim from these clustering methods is nothing but a good clustering method should majorly produce high quality clusters, which are nothing but there should be high intra class similarity. That is, within the cluster, the similarity between all the data objects should be more. So, that is high intra class similarity, and outside the cluster or between clusters, the relation between the other two cluster, the relation between these two clusters should be, the similarity should be less, as possible. So low interclass similarity and high intra-class similarity is what we are looking at in terms of defining a cluster. So whenever we employ a method to identify the different groups of items or to identify better method, the better method should provide us a value which has high intra-class similarity and low inter-class similarity. The quality of clustering result depends on both the similarity measure used by the method and its implementation. The quality of clustering method is also measured by its ability to discover some or all the hidden patterns. So, any number of patterns that has been generated by looking at closer sum of the patterns or by looking at all the patterns, we might come out with definition of a quality cluster. But there are certain data objects which may not prevail under any of this category. So, they can be put out as an default value and this will be further called as an outlier value. Looking at the different approaches that we have towards clustering. So, major clustering approaches like partition clustering, where it is similar to our tree based construction, but then we partition it here. We construct various partitions and then evaluate them by some criteria. So, we try dividing every a property and we understand that every property belongs to a partition, or otherwise it can be by hierarchical based algorithms, where we create a hierarchy by decomposing a set of data objects using similar criterion, or we look at the density values based on connectivity and density functions, we try dividing the data objects. So, these are some of the methods which we try deploying it to the for the formation of clusters. Not only that, apart from density based methods, we have also got grid based methods. By employing these grid based methods, we may have to divide given a data object into multiple levels, looking at the granular information associated with the clusters. So, looking at the fine grained details of every cluster, we can in turn divide that into a cluster. So, multiple level granularity structure can also be built, which are termed to be as grid based. And finally, we have a model based, where we search for an hypothesis, and for each hypothesis of a cluster, and the idea is to find the best fit of that model to each other. So, where it best fits to that particular model is to be identified by deriving an hypothesis. So, those were the methods that we have studied. We have looked at partition based algorithms, we have looked at hierarchical based algorithms, we have also looked at density based algorithms, grid based, and so. So, by employing any one of these methods, we can clearly distinguish on the different clusters, or we can identify how many clusters, and we can look at to which cluster given a data object should go and reside with. But during the part of discussion, I have told you there can be certain data values which can never belong to any of these properties, or the characteristic that associated with the newly formed data object might not fit into any of these. So, in that case, it is clearly distinguished as an outlier data which is not belonging to any of the cluster, and the properties entirely vary from any of the clusters defined. So, the set of objects are considerably dissimilar from the remainder of the data. So, how many ever data that appears, there seems to be no similarity that is existing between the data values. So, here may it be an intra-cluster similarity or inter-cluster similarity, it does not have to be on any of these cases, then it is purely said as an outlier. So, the problem is to find the top n outlier points. So, these outliers are majorly detected with fraud detection, or majorly been applied for fraud detection, telecom fraud detection. Maybe you might have frequent callers and you might have callers from unknown numbers. By use of an application called Truecaller, we are able to distinguish whether to pick the call or whether it is a spam call. it has been basically identified by a third party or any third party which whom we are trying to contact. If it is not there in the contact list and if it has been an advertisement or clearly a person who is trying to be a fraudulent to this system, we identify that quite even, and it marks up for customer segmentation also, trying to identify who, what group of customers. Frequently grouped people might belong to a cluster, and any person who has just gone in and gone out without making a similar purchases might be considered as outlier. We can apply this for medical analysis systems also, where previously defined category for classification, we have used it for benign and malignant tumors, but then there exists a tumor, but then we will not be able to identify to which tumor it belonged to. And not only that, this might look as a tumor and it may also not be a tumor, it can be well treated with a simplistic approaches also. So, in that particular case also, we might consider this as an outlier. In short, we have started looking at the different clusters or how these clusters might be helpful in data mining. I was trying to explain you in terms of unsupervised learning. So, majorly we made it as a classification between supervised and unsupervised learning. As part of unsupervised learning, we termed it majorly for clustering purposes, where we do not have a previously defined class labels and any data object will reside into any one of the defined clusters. So, cluster analysis groups objects based on similarity and has to be used for wider range of applications. So, we look at similarity between all the data points. So, this similarity can be identified maybe by use of measure which is called Euclidean distance measure. So, you have variant volumes of distance measure available that you would have studied. So, by looking at those distance measures, we can initially tend to identify the similarity between two different data objects. By studying on the similarity, we can create a structure which can say that between or within the cluster, there are a group of items within the cluster which has the higher similar values, and I create one more cluster which can form another similar group, but then between clusters there seems to be a less of similarity. So, that way I tend to create a lot of clusters. So, similarity plays a vital role in form of creation of a cluster. So, analysis is primarily made by depending on the similarity value. One of the similarity measure that I have hinted here is the Euclidean distance measure, which is square root of x 1 minus x 2 the whole square plus y 1 minus y 2 the whole square. We tend to understand between two data objects in terms of x and y points. X 1 refers to x 1 comma y 1 refers to one of the data point, and x 2 comma y 2 refers to the other data point data object that is present in the cluster. So, we study the similarity between these two clusters. If it is found to be very minimal, then this can be clustered together. So, that is the first indication. And measure of similarity can be computed for various types of data. Any number of data can be considered, and various group of data can also be considered, and for measuring the similarity between the data points. And we have looked at several clustering algorithms, starting from partition based, hierarchical based, density based, grid based algorithms, and purely these algorithms were talking on the categorization of the data and not on the classification of the data. So, categorization of the data is primarily been important rather than continual data values. And we have also looked at the outliers which does not come under any of the categories. So, there seems to be no similar values that is existing as part of the cluster items. So, if I try to insert a data point, but that this data point does not come under any of the criteria that has been defined for creation of a cluster, then this seems to be a dissimilar value, and this is also termed to be a outlier detection. So, this is an outlier, and we can detect on the outlier and make an analysis on the outlier, which helps us in identifying frauds, which also helps in telecom based applications, and this can be performed by statistical measures, distance based measures, or any deviation based approaches. And there are still a lot of research which goes on the cluster analysis, like constraint based clustering. Given a specific constraint, depending on the constraint, how many clusters can be created and what can be the outlier as part of this clusters created. So, there is so much of research which is going on in this particular clustering analysis also. Thank you.